We were discussing nuclear fission and its explanation on the basis of liquid drop model. Actually, we have learnt that a heavy nucleus disintegrate into two fragments, and the masses of the two fragments are more or less equal, and a large amount of energy is released in this process, and this process is known as nuclear fission. Actually, we have also discussed the percentage yield during the nuclear fission in against of mass number. Actually, this yield varies with mass number, and from the variation of percentage yield versus mass number, we have learned that the percentage yield is maximum when the mass number is 95 and 139. And it is minimum when the mass number is 118. Apart from this, we have also explained in qualitative manner the fission, why the fission takes place. The explanation was based on the liquid drop model of nucleus, which were developed by Bohr and Wheeler. Actually, in this explanation, we have assumed only qualitative aspect. And we have learnt that when the fissile nucleus is struck by the neutron is captured by the nucleus and a compound nucleus is formed. And this compound nucleus actually gains the energy from the projectile and get distorted and start oscillation. And during this oscillation, the shape of the nucleus is distorted and two lobes or two halves are developed. And the repulsion, due to the repulsion between the two halves get separated and fission takes place. So these are what we have learnt in the first part of this lecture. Today we are going to discuss the explanation of the fission on the basis of liquid drop model in mathematical way, or you can say we are giving just a mathematical analysis of the process fission in this lecture. Actually, to treat the problem theoretically, we treat the nucleus to be spherical initially. When you say initially, what does it mean? It means when the projectile does not strike the nucleus. In fact, in that condition, we assume that the nucleus is spherical. And it is made up of incompressible nuclear fluid having a well-defined surface and constant volume. In fact, this is the assumption of liquid drop model, that in this model, we assume that the nucleus is made up of incompressible fluid and its volume is constant. On account of this incompressibility, the vibration set up in the nucleus due to the absorption of a neutron cannot penetrate any deep but remain confined to the surface of the drop only. And of course, the deformation produced in the nucleus may be of any type, but for mathematical simplicity, we assume that in the lowest excitation of the drop, the nucleus still maintains its axial symmetry. Now, for calculation, let us choose this axis of symmetry as the polar axis of the spherical drop. We assume it for mathematical simplicity in spherical polar coordinates. In fact, the distorted radial coordinate of a point on the surface of the liquid drop, that is the nucleus, can be expressed in terms of Legendre polynomials. You know, whenever we have to discuss such a problem, the discussion will be in terms of Legendre polynomial. So the distorted radial coordinate of a point on the surface we can express in terms of Legendre polynomials, and so we write that the polar coordinate of a point on the surface of the nucleus at a position r theta phi is given in this manner. This is r theta equal to r naught 1 plus summation over I from 0 to infinity alpha I pi cos theta. Here actually this alpha I is what you know, this alpha I is actually deformation parameter, and r0, this is radius of the undeformed spherical drop. That is when the projectile does not hit the nucleus. In that condition, nucleus was maintaining a spherical symmetry, and the radius of that sphere was r0. And r theta is actually the deformed radius at a position r theta phi. And this pi cos theta, this is Legendre polynomials, as you know. Now, the requirement of constant volume, as I have told you, that we are considering this explanation on the basis of liquid drop model. And in liquid drop model, as I have told you, that we consider that the volume of the drop remains constant, although it gets deformed, but its volume will not change. So if we consider that the volume remains constant, this is possible only when the zeroth order and the first order deformation constant will be zero. Why? Why for this zeroth order and first order deformation constant should be coefficient should be zero? Because you know that even after deformation, the center of mass of the drop is assumed to be remain unchanged. And if we assume that center of mass of the drop remains unchanged, this is possible only when the zero order and the first order deformation parameter is zero. So let us write it first. The requirement of constant volume, specifies that the zeroth order deformation parameter, that is, we will write it alpha zero, this should be zero, and the first order deformation parameter, which we will write alpha one, this should be also zero. Only then we can assume that the volume remains constant. And the reason behind this is what? That even in the deformed state, the center of mass of the nucleus should remain at the same position, that it should remain unchanged. So you can write, because the center of mass, that is CM, of the drop is assumed to remain unchanged. And hence, from this equation 1, you can find the value of r theta, or you can expand the summation term inside this square bracket, keeping alpha 0 and alpha 1 as 0. So we will have, when I equal to 0, then this Legendre, the term containing the Legendre polynomial will 0, and when I will be 1, then again this term containing the Legendre polynomial pi cos theta will be 0. So what will be the expansion in this condition? You can see that this will be r theta equal to r naught into 1 plus, we will take the first value of I equal to 2, because the value of alpha corresponding to I equal to 0 and I equal to 1 is 0. So this will be alpha 2 p2 plus alpha 3 p3 and plus so on. It will run to up to infinity. Actually, the surface energy of the spherical drop, you know, is related to the surface tension of the liquid. And so we can write the expression for the surface energy of the spherical drop. We know that surface tension is defined as the surface energy per unit surface area. And so if we will multiply the surface area of the liquid drop to its surface tension, then we will get actually its surface energy. So when the nucleus is in fact in its original shape, that is a spherical shape before the disturbance, in that condition, what is the surface energy of the liquid drop? We can find it. So the surface energy of the undeformed, when deformation does not take place, undeformed spherical liquid drop, is given as, you know, the drop, the nucleus was treated as a liquid drop, and this liquid drop is a spherical, and in undeformed state its radius is r naught. And you know, if we denote this energy by es naught, we know that the surface energy is the product of the surface tension and the surface area. So if we denote the surface tension by the symbol S and surface area by A, so this will be S into A. Now you know what will be the surface area of this spherical drop whose radius is r naught. This will be simply 4 pi r naught square. And so you can write it as 4 pi r naught square into S. And let us say this is equation 3. As I have told you, this S is what? This is surface tension of the nuclear liquid. And this A, which is actually equal to 4 pi r naught square, this is actually the surface area of the drop. This is actually the surface energy of a spherical drop before deformation, that is in initial state. Now we will find the surface energy when the nucleus gets deformed. You know, in this condition, there is not a unique value of radius because the spherical symmetry is not maintained. So in this condition, we will take simply an elementary area on the surface of the deformed nucleus. See here, I am showing that nucleus has been deformed, and we take an elementary area on its surface. This is its elementary area, let us say. So in this condition, if we will find the surface energy of this elementary area, and let us say for this radius, this distance is r, then we can find the total surface energy simply by integrating that result. So now the surface energy of the deformed nucleus. In fact, if we denote it by the symbol ES, S for surface, then what will be this? This will be, in fact, surface tension times integral of the elementary surface area d. Actually, Bohr and Wheeler found the expression for this quantity ES. So I am here mentioning directly the expression which was actually found by Bohr and Wheeler while they had proposed the liquid drop model in terms of the deformation parameter. So you can say, according to Bohr and Wheeler, the surface energy, of the deformed nucleus, in terms of deformation parameters, alpha I is what? Actually, I am writing this expression directly from the result obtained by Bohr and Wheeler. Actually, this is given as ES equal to the initial surface area, which is actually A, times surface tension, that is S, and into 1 plus 2 over 5 alpha 2 square plus 5 over 7 alpha 3 square and so on. Actually, you know this A is actually equal to 4 pi r naught square, and surface tension is S, so we can write it as 4 pi r naught square times S into 1 plus 2 over 5 alpha 2 square plus 5 over 7 alpha 3 square plus so on. So this is actually the expression for the energy of the deformed nucleus which has been obtained by Bohr and Wheeler in his theory. And so I have mentioned this result directly here. So this is the value of ES, and say this is equation 5. Now, apart from this surface energy due to the surface tension, the undeformed nucleus and the deformed nucleus has also the Coulombian energy, because you know that there is Coulombian interaction inside the nucleus, and so due to the Coulombian interaction, energy is developed. So now we will find what is the value of the Coulomb energy for the undeformed liquid drop and for the deformed liquid drop. We will write the expression for them. So now the Coulomb energy. Coulomb energy for the undeformed rock. Undeformed drop, that is the drop which was not deformed, that is given as, you know what is the expression for the Coulomb energy for a spherical charged body. We write it in this manner in SI unit. This is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught 3 over 5 into ZE whole square over R naught over R naught. Here actually Z is the number of protons. You know this Z is total number of protons in the nucleus, and E is charge of one of the proton, and so Ze is the total positive charge of the nucleus. And now in case of deformed nucleus, the Coulomb energy will be expressed again in terms of the deformation parameter, and the result for this I am writing here directly from the Bohr-Wheeler theory. So the energy means Coulomb energy of the deformed nucleus, this will be again in terms of the deformation parameters alpha I, and it is given as, if we denote it by EC, this is given as 3 over 5 into ZE whole square over 4 pi epsilon naught into R naught into 1 minus 1 over 5 alpha 2 square and minus 10 over 40 alpha 3 square and minus so on. So these are the expression for the surface energy due to surface tension and Coulomb energy due to Coulombian interaction. Now you can find what will be the total energy of the undeformed nucleus and that of the deformed nucleus. You will find that both are not same, and so definitely after deformation there will be an energy change, and you can see that the energy change. Energy change due to deformation. Due to deformation of the nucleus. What will be the energy change due to deformation of nucleus? You know, if we denote this energy change by delta E, what will be it? This will be final energy of the nucleus, that is the total energy of nucleus in deformed state, and minus its total energy in undeformed state. So this will be simply ES plus EC. This is total energy of the deformed nucleus and minus ES naught plus EC naught. Now we will substitute the values of this ES not ES and EC which we have just obtained earlier. So you can see what is the value of this ES. You can see this 4 pi r naught square s. Actually, see this equation, that is the equation number 3, that this 4 pi r naught square s is simply ES naught. And so you can see that this expression can be written as ES naught times 1 plus 2 over alpha, alpha 2 over 5, alpha 2 square. Actually, I am neglecting here the higher order deformation parameter, because the values of the higher order deformation parameter is so small that we can neglect it. So I am taking just one of the deformation parameter, that is alpha 2. So this is just an approximate result. And now what will be this EC? You can see that this EC is what? You can see this equation 7, that EC is this much. And see the equation 6, that this factor 3 over 5 ZE whole square 4 pi epsilon naught R naught, this is actually EC naught. So you can write this expression in this manner, that this is EC naught into 1 minus 1 over 5 alpha 2 square, alpha 2 square. Here again I have neglected the terms containing the higher order deformation parameter. As I have told you, we are considering the first order deformation, and so we do not consider the higher order deformation parameter. And minus ES naught plus EC naught. Now you can see that this ES naught and EC naught will cancel out, and our result will be what? You can see this is simply 2 over 5 ES naught into alpha 2 square and minus 1 over 5 EC naught alpha 2 square. And so you can write the expression for this energy change, which I have denoted by the symbol delta E after deformation, that this will be 1 over 5 alpha 2 square into 2 ES naught minus EC naught. This is actually the expression for the change in energy of the deformed nucleus. Now you can see in this expression that the surface energy term, that is ES naught, appears with a positive sign, and the Coulomb energy term, which is EC naught, appears with a negative sign. So definitely the stability of a nucleus against the spontaneous fission is defined in terms of the value of delta E, that delta is being positive or it is negative. And the sign of this delta E, that is, it is either positive or negative or zero, that will depend on the relative value of this ES naught and EC naught. So you can see that there will be actually three situations. You can see here, if delta E is positive, you can see if delta is positive, when delta E will be positive, you can see easily that this is possible when EC naught will be less than 2 ES naught, then you can see this is positive. In fact, in this condition, the nucleus is stable. So this implies न्यूक्लियस इज स्टेबल एंड इफ दिस डेल्टा ई इज नेगेटिव, डेल्टा ई इज नेगेटिव एंड व्हेन दिस डेल्टा ई विल बी नेगेटिव यू कैन सी इट इज पॉसिबल व्हेन ई सी नॉट विल बी ग्रेटर देन 2ES नॉट एंड इन फैक्ट इन दिस कंडीशन द न्यूक्लियस इज अनस्टेबल, न्यूक्लियस इज अनस्टेबल अनस्टेबल. नाउ व्हेन दिस डेल्टा ई इज इक्वल टू जीरो यू कैन सी when this delta E is zero, when it will be possible? It is possible only when this EC naught will be equal to 2ES naught. Actually, this situation represents the critical condition. That when you say critical condition, what does it mean? It means the nucleus is just at the state of stability and just at the state of instability. So, in this condition, we say that this is the state of critical condition. So this is critical condition. Critical condition. Actually, we will consider the situation of delta E equal to zero. That is the critical condition. And you know when there is critical condition, then EC naught will be equal to 2ES naught. So now let us find a particular parameter which will be actually called a particular critical value of a fissionable parameter, in terms of which we can decide the nucleus will be suffer either the spontaneous fission or not. So now, in critical case, you have seen in critical case that this is, this 2ES naught is equal to EC naught. Now let us substitute the value of this ES naught and EC naught here. You know that ES naught is what? This is 4 pi r naught square into s. And what is this EC naught? You have seen this is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught into 3 over 5 ze whole square over r naught. And you can see from here that this R naught is what? This is actually the radius of the deformed nucleus. And you know the radius of the spherical nucleus is related to its mass number. And it is given as R naught equal to R naught into a to the power 1 by 3. And here, actually, this R naught is a constant having value 1.2 Fermi FM, or you may write it 1.1 FM. This is so small that there is no difference between 1.2 FM and 1.1 FM. So you will find its value in some book as 1.2 FM and in some books it is 1.1 FM. So now let us substitute the value of this R naught equal to this small r naught into a to the power 1 over 3 in this expression. And so you can see that this will be 8 pi r naught square. See here, from here this capital R naught square will be what? This will be a small r naught square into a to the power 2 by 3 into surface tension S, and this is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught into 3 over 5 into ZE whole square over R naught. And see the value of R naught here. This is a small R naught into A to the power 1 by 3. So this will be R naught into A to the power 1 by 3. And so you can see, simplify this result in an easy manner. You can see that we can write this result in this manner. This is Z square over A. This will be equal to what? This is 4 pi epsilon naught into 40 pi small r naught square into S divided by 3e square. Actually, in the RHS of this equation, all quantities have a standard value. So taking the average surface tension for nuclear fluid and R naught, I have mentioned that this is 1.2 fm. So if we will substitute the value of all the quantities in RHS of this equation, it is then found to be approximately 50. This is a very remarkable result, that this Z square over A is almost equal to 50. Actually, this ratio of Z square with A is defined as a critical value of this Z square over A. So this actually defines the critical value of Z square over A, because we have found this value of Z square over A in critical condition, that is when you have taken that the Coulombian energy EC naught is equal to twice of the surface energy of the undeformed nucleus. So this is denoted by a particular symbol. We should indicate here that this is a critical value of Z square over A. So as this value of Z square over A is its critical value. So we denote it by Z square over A C. We use the subscript C to denote the critical value of this ratio Z square over A. Now actually, we will define a quantity which is called fissionable parameter. And this fissionable parameter is defined as a number which is actually the ratio of the value of this Z square over A with its critical value. So now, fissionable parameter. This is denoted by chi, and this is defined as the ratio of Z square over A and the critical value of Z square over A. This is in fact the value of Z square over A in any condition, and in an denominator it is the value of Z square over A in critical condition. So we define it in this manner. Now the value of this fissionable parameter actually decides that the nucleus is stable against spontaneous fission, or it is unstable in against of the spontaneous fission. So in fact there will be two situations. First of all, when this fissionable parameter is less than 1. It means z square over a is less than the critical value of z square over a. Actually, in this implies that the nucleus is stable against the spontaneous fission. Nucleus is stable against spontaneous fission. But if this fissionable parameter chi is greater than 1, in fact, this value of chi represents that the nucleus is not stable, but it is unstable against the spontaneous fission. So this is nucleus is unstable against the spontaneous fission. So you can say that when this fissionable parameter is less than 1, then actually a spontaneous fission will not take place. And when this fissionable parameter is greater than 1, then actually the spontaneous fission takes place. So this is all about the explanation of the